Music and Booze with Mo is co-produced and distributed by Nitty Grits, the media division of the National Food and Beverage Foundation, changing the world one taste at a time. Welcome to Music and Booze with Mo. I'm Mo Herms, and I've worked in the music industry most of my life, so have met some pretty amazing musicians over the years. I also love a good cocktail, and I've encountered some really interesting bartenders as well. It seems that there is a lot of crossover, so when I can, I like to talk to musicians and bartenders about music and booze. Join us at the bar, won't you? Music and Booze with Mo is brought to you by The Mermaid, a cozy neighborhood bar with an aquatic flair in the Little Tokyo area of downtown LA. Open 7 days a week, featuring tropical cocktails and snacks, The Mermaid also has a daily happy hour from 5 to 8 p.m. Follow The Mermaid on Instagram at TheMermaidLA to hear about upcoming events and check them out at TheMermaidLA.com. Head to 428 East 2nd Street, Los Angeles, for a drink. On this episode, we sit with Hope Ewing, who has just put out a book called Movers and Shakers, Women Making Waves in Spirits, Beer, and Wine. We'll sit down and talk about that, talk about her jobs in Los Angeles, serving up delicious cocktails as well as New York, and her time as a dancer, and also loving music, going out clubbing, all that kind of stuff. So we have a good time here with Hope today, so stick around, listen more, and learn about Movers and Shakers, Women Making Waves in Spirits, Beer, and Wine. And, you know, a whole bunch of other things.
Lives, beautiful Los Angeles lives. So yes, we're sitting outside at the Row, the Row DTLA, I think is what they call it.
Yeah.
And tell everybody who you are and where we are, I guess, exactly.
Okay, so I'm Hope Ewing. I wrote a book. It's called Movers and Shakers, Women Making Waves in Spirits, Beer, and Wine. And we are outside my workplace at the Rappahannock Oyster Bar in downtown L.A.
Oh, thank you for saying it, because I just spell it out. Rappahannock. It's exactly the way it looks.
It's spelled phonetically. It's definitely... Yeah.
It's just a daunting word. You look at it, it's very long. Rappahannock.
A lot of syllables. Yeah.
There's a lot in there.
It's their first... So Rappahannock is sort of... It is actually a restaurant on the East Coast, and they own the oyster farms. They started opening restaurants to sell their own oysters.
Nice.
And it's a whole fun story that people can look up on the internet about. Because it's great, but I'm not, you know...
You're like, but they're established. I'm not. It's but you are, because you're putting out a book.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. You're putting out a book, which is amazing. So, well, first I want to just say we have wonderful, wonderful drinks sitting in front of us, which we were just talking about. And there's an evolving beverage menu here.
So this is what we are. I'm calling it the Training Wheels cocktail menu, because we are beer and wine only, but that allows for fortified wine, allows for wine-based amari and sake and soju. And a lot of fun things that are sort of easy to go with. And I do feel like it's a trend. I hate the word trend, because I feel like people use it derisively, but I do feel like there's a rising tide of lower alcohol, low ABV drinks.
There absolutely are.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Like session cocktails. So, you know, I feel like it kind of is timely in that manner. Until we get our liquor license, then it's just going to be all Manhattans all the time.
But you're well-versed in cocktails anyway.
Yeah, so I've been bartending for, I've been bartending altogether off and on for the past 15, 20 years. I worked in sports bars and neighborhood pubs in New York City,
Yeah, that's how you learn the volume stuff, right?
It is. Well, and more importantly, it's how you learn service. Like, you know, it's how you learn how to talk to people and not freeze up and not be a jerk.
which I think only be a jerk when there's absolutely no recourse.
Right.
Or even then.
Only be a jerk when you're allowed to. And
yep.
only give it back. Never give it first. But
you've been here in Los Angeles for a while now.
For about 5 years, so not a huge amount of time, but, you know, I'm getting good enough to just enjoy it a lot. And so, I moved out here after I got my MFA in creative writing.
Oh, okay.
So the whole story basically is I was a fundraiser. I worked in grants and fundraising for New York City arts organizations.
Wow.
For most of the 2000s. And then, 2010, 2011, I was fortunately laid off before I quit. My whole department was cut from this, I was working at an acting school and just not having very much fun and just realizing it wasn't for me.
Yeah.
It was like sitting at a desk was never for me, sort of doing the same thing every day was never for me, but I was trying to kind of still put that square peg in that round hole for 8 years. And then, and so I went back to school. I got my, got my MFA and then burned out on fiction. It was just, I never want to look at a computer screen again. I'm so upset. But luckily I started bartending when I was in school, which I feel like is the story, having now interviewed dozens of women who are bartenders or distillers or brewers and winemakers, which is what the book is about. Having done all these interviews with all these women with cool jobs, it's like so many of them started off like, while I was doing this I was doing this to make ends meet when I was in school, and then I finished school and I didn't do anything with that and I just
stayed,
kept bartending, or kept doing whatever. So I feel like I'm in good company.
Yes.
Like, my favorite story is probably Missy Kalkofen from, she works for Delmagay. She has for years.
Oh, wow.
She's like, so her title is Madrina.
Nice. That's so cool.
Like, she's one of like the early adopters of like trying to push mezcal around the country, around the U.S. That is. Mm-hmm. But she was actually in Harvard Divinity School.
Oh my God.
Yeah, like she was.
She's going to be a nun.
Or at least be in
some sort of order.
She's definitely going to be a religious scholar. I don't really know.
Wow. Well, Divinity School is pretty dedicated to.
Divinity.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
I
dedicated to the cause.
I had to look it up. When
just
after
to make sure it wasn't just nunnery.
Like, what do you actually do out of divinity school? I guess. However, it is a lot about community building and obviously religious communities. But I was like, that kind of does go hand in hand with hospitality in a
lot
of ways.
Yeah.
Although, if you talk to any bartenders. The more I'm like, you can kind of relate to anything. You're like, no, it has to do with community. It's people coming together. It's just like being in a bar. It's about art.
Oh, well, I talk about, so you are a creative person working in the bar community. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the reasons I started this podcast was because I met so many musicians that worked in the bar community.
Yes.
And there is this, and you know, we've expanded, obviously, it's like, it's not always musicians. Sometimes we just sit here and talk about music, obviously music and booze.
Mm-hmm.
Because music is, if you're a creative person, you love music too. You know, it's in there. And so you're finding just that creativity, that hospitality, there's something in the way that kind of brain works.
Right. I think so. Mm-hmm. And you know what? Being like an adult with like extreme like ADHD hyperactivity issues, I'm like, that's every time I'm just like, it's the nonlinear brain. This is our, it's my cloud brain just pulling things.
What inspired you to start this book? Is this the first book you've written?
This is my first book.
Wow. So you finally got your book out, and it happened to be on what had been your backup gig that became your full-time gig.
Exactly.
That's so cool.
Yeah, after I moved to L.A., I followed a guy, came out here. He was in the film industry and wanted to start a career, and I was like, great, I can wait tables. I can work at a bar while you're figuring this out.
Yeah.
So when I did that, and I got into the craft cocktail community here, and I learned all the things, and I got, you take your deep nerd dive at some point.
Right,
and,
yeah.
You know, you're just like, you learn everything about all the booze. And then I started writing about liquor, and then that just sort of fortuitously came together with my editor Olivia, who we actually came together, and she was, she said, I want more positive stories about women in booze. She's like, I see a lot of sobriety memoirs, I see a lot of like stories about terrible things that happen when women drink or are involved in this. And she's a sommelier and hadn't had that same experience. I hadn't had that same experience. So I was like, where are all the stories about these like amazing women that we're meeting? I mean, at least with guys, when the tragedies are, when the drinking stories are tragedies, they're at least cool. I'm like, I don't want to... I feel like as I get older, I think like Raymond Carver and Ernest Hemingway and all that stuff is, I think it's less cool.
It's less cool, for sure.
To drink yourself into, you know, a bad state.
It's way less cool.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's someone like...
But there's a mystique to it.
Didn't you interview Joyce Spence?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Whom I've never met. And Joyce Spence, well, you can let folks know who she is, because when I learned about her... She became a hero to me, like, right away.
Oh, my God. Yeah, Joyce Spence is the master blender of Appleton Estate Rum. And she is, I don't know.
When did she start?
Starstruck.
Like, yeah, oh, absolutely. And I saw her speak once, and she was so engaging and so charismatic. And how long has she been the master distiller?
So she's been she's the master blender.
Master blender, sorry.
Slightly different, but it's, like, also being, with rum, it's, like, that's where the control is, like, because you're actually making what the product tastes like. And she's been in that role since 1997. She was actually the first
right?
lady female master distiller or master
I know
the first female master blender in the world that anybody knows. So, yeah, I mean, and she got into that because she was a scientist. She was a chemist. And her story is actually fantastic because she was raised to go to med school and be a doctor. You know, I think that was her. She was a girl. She was good at science. You know, she went to university and they're like, okay, you're going to be a doctor. And she was just like, I can't handle trauma. She's like, I just freeze up. I won't save anybody's life. Like, this is a bad idea. So she went into chemistry and then she started working brewery and then she started working at Appleton Distillery the Appleton Rum Distillery. And just, you know, I think she was there for something like 10 years and then became the boss.
Yeah.
And, amazing. You know, and is still doing it. And I asked her, I was just like, are you, you know, how long are you going to hold out? Is it going to be, are you going to be like the queen? You know, are you like the queen of England here? You're just like sticking in. She's like, she was like, when I get tired of traveling and speaking, I'll step back.
Then she'll stop.
But
yeah,
she does so much like education, like you said.
Yeah, because I saw her in New Orleans. So what, for you... So you started, this was your backup gig, then it became your full-time gig. Yeah. Now you've taken it to the level of finding new heroes for other women to learn about and also interviewing some of your own to do this book. So what happens for you next? Obviously, you're going to be on a book tour for a while. And you're pushing this thing around.
Yeah, I will be. I'm going to go to New York. I got to, you know, we're going to New York, Boston. Got a big thing in St. Louis, which is where my boyfriend is from. And I'm going to have a conversation with amazing... bar owner there, Natasha Barami from the Gin Room, St. Louis. I'm like, November 14th. St. Louis, Missouri. So that's going to be most of the fall. And then, you know, I'm developing cocktails here. We're kind of getting off the ground.
Then there's all that, but you're still here. And so there's a... Now, you've worked, I think, when I met you, you were at Mess Hall.
Yes.
And then you were also, here's looking at you, which is funny because we hadn't seen each other in like a year or so. And you hit me first. You're like, oh my God, that was you. I'm so sorry. I'm like, oh, I thought you seemed familiar, but it'd been a while. And so you've been just neck deep in creating wonderful cocktails. So you're here as the beverage director.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah, at Rappahannock. Wait, did I say it right?
Rappahannock.
Yeah. I had to look up. I'm looking at the sign. Rappahannock. There we go. You guys will be hopefully getting your license soon.
Get that 47. We're in the process.
And it takes a while and everything. So in the meantime, you get to extend that creativity to the low ABV stuff. But we know that you can do the... Let's call it the high ABV stuff as well.
Strong.
So in talking to any of these fabulous women in booze, did you get any ideas when you were talking with them about like your own creativity in terms of behind the bar?
I mean, I'm definitely, and not just with the recipe, you know,
You talk to brewers too, right?
Yeah, brewers and winemakers and distillers. There's like... I'm like, I can't
I'm
even
totally
remember.
Sipping
and, like,
some of this.
Please do. That's what it's supposed to be. You're supposed to be.
You're supposed to drink.
Supposed to go from solid to liquid, and it's good.
Oh, cool. Basically. Yes, because it's like I had ice cream served to me, sort of, but now it's a beautiful, melty cocktail on a lovely warm day.
Yeah, I do. I do some work with a catering company called the Grand Bevy here, mm-hmm. which actually, if you ever get a chance to talk to Richard Rick Swan from Grand Bevy, he's a rock, you know, former rock and roll musician who's got some great stories, and he's an amazing bartender. But
we'll get that number later.
All right. Yes, absolutely.
But you and your inspiration.
But so, and they, we did a froze activation for an event, and then I left that just being like, I want to make froze every day.
Well, I remember you emailed me, and you're like, there will be froze.
There will be froze. It's gonna be frozen. It may be pink. It might be red. It might be white.
None of these things are bad things.
No.
It's all wonderful.
But I'm like, we're in Los Angeles. You can eat ice cream all year round. Let's do it.
Yeah, it's true.
But, a lot of them, like, were inspiring, you know, like, Carrie Hoff from Big Bar, you know, has amazing, you know, she hit it really hard being like, you know, you don't have to follow a set path. You can absolutely make your own way. And she has this, you know, her career is a tale of jumping from one thing to the other and just doing whatever the F you want.
Yeah, totally.
So, I mean, so is that kind of inspiration? And then there's people like, or like Mary Bartlett, who was at, she was formerly of the Ace, and now she's making gin.
Oh, wow.
She was the bartender manager at Honeycut here for many years. Mm-hmm. And then she was the beverage director at the Ace. And then, but anyway.
Which gin is she making? Is she Green Bar? No.
It's brand new.
Okay.
And I don't remember.
Off the top of your head. Totally fine. Get the book. You'll know. Movies and Shakers.
No, but that actually happened since I talked to her, too. And I was I had to put an addendum in. I'm just like, by the way. I actually had to do that a bunch of times because people move and shake. And people are moving around and doing so many different things that it's like, it's a very mobile career choice, right? Mm-hmm. Like, as I guess it is with any artist type thing.
I mean, you never played music, right?
You know what? I didn't. I sang and I did musical theater in high school and college, and I was a dancer.
But
so
you sang.
I did. And I still do sing a lot in my car. And
I think we all sing in our car.
Yes.
And we all sing really well in our car.
I know,
it's
amazing.
In the shower. It's wonderful.
Yes. And in K-Town, after midnight, after soju. Yes.
After soju. So which drink is going to make you, which one of your frosés is going to make you sing the most, do you think?
Oh, my God. I mean, this one's pretty killer. It does have soju in it. So I feel like soju, no matter what, is a facilitator to karaoke at any given point.
And the soju drink we have in front of us is the one, I think, I'm trying to remember if we talked about it on tape or not at the beginning. So remind me what this one is called.
So that one is called the Ghostface Chilla.
Ghost.
Because
why did we not start with that?
And you know what? I kind of went back and forth. I was like, I don't know. Is the cute cocktail name thing over? And I'm like, I don't care.
No, just do it.
I love cute cocktail names. I'll die with cute cocktail names.
Ghostface Chilla.
Ghostface Chilla. Uh-huh. Because our chef here, Nick Urban, said that it tasted like Tang.
Yes.
He said that is a good thing.
He thinks it tastes like Tang. I don't think it tastes like Tang.
Tang, well, Tang, Blue Tang. I'm not going to call it ODB. Oh, it's Ghostface Chilla. So that was that process. But it does
have an orange thing going on here.
Yeah. Like it's the color of Tang, but it's basically a soju white Negroni with Cappelletti and Elysian vermouth, which is an amazing vermouth made by made by a woman, made by Heather Hawkins in San Francisco, in the Bay Area. I'm sorry, in Sonoma.
That's cool. Okay.
Not in San Francisco.
That's
Sonoma.
North of that, yeah.
I don't want anybody to get upset with me, but yeah, the Elysian Vermouth, Elysian Bianco, which is one
amazing.
Of my favorites.
It's super tasty. And this has the orange
The orange flower water.
Yes, orange flower water. So it goes face chilla. So it doesn't make me think of Wu-Tang when I drink it, but I love that it's called Ghostface Chilla. Are you a Wu-Tang fan?
I'm sort of peripherally. Like, that was my most of my hip-hop experience is, like, sort of dancing quietly behind the bar, like, trying not to... Definitely trying. Well, and that is the thing, is that I'm the bar dancer. Like, that's every time I leave a job, they're like, oh, the new person won't dance.
I dance when I DJ. Yeah. So if I DJ out at clubs or at bars, mm-hmm. or whatever, I always dance along. And I realize that not a lot of DJs do that. They're too serious about the craft. Yeah,
right,
totally.
Right.
So, you know.
I don't know.
Can't help it. You feel the music. Well, you said you were a dancer, too.
Right. And
so
I used to, yeah.
What kind of dancing did you do?
So I was a little dance studio rat in my little town where I grew up in Western New York State, mm-hmm. Which it's, you know, it's New York State, but it's, for all intents and purposes, kind of Pennsylvania.
Yeah.
Sorry, Western New York, but about 50 miles south of Buffalo. And there was a local dance studio, and I studied ballet and tap and jazz, mm-hmm. and modern dance.
I took jazz dance when I was young. My mom was a ballerina, so I feel you on this.
Mm-hmm. So she had messed up feet.
That's what she had.
Yeah.
But
I'm like, and that's essentially why I did that from kindergarten up until like my sophomore year of college.
Yeah.
And then I was just like, I'm not going to do this professionally, and the people are really mean, and nobody eats. And
I like food too much.
I like food too much. I don't want to smoke all the time.
Well, so you like dancing already, mm-hmm. so then what was your favorite stuff to go out dancing to? This is what the memories of.
So,
yeah, this is where the music thing comes in.
I mean, but so that's when, like, I would always go to, like, the hip-hop R&B night or the reggae night or whatever, because it's just anything with sort of a very, like, I always had a hard time when it's too sort of housey, like, when the beat is too, like, driving.
Too militaristic.
Yeah.
That's how I used to think of early rave music, sounded like marching, kind of, you know,
had that
sort of beat.
And So when I was in New York, there was like a monthly dance party. It was Wonderground.
Okay, that sounds good.
My friend Cav. What's up, Cav? he and his friends in Bed-Stuy, Brooklyn would put on this this dance party, and they called it Wonderground. And it was this amazing mix of music, but I would go to that with my coworkers. And I was in my early 30s at the time, and like I just remember leaving it with a new friend, and her going, you know, I love going out dancing with you. You make me so unselfconscious.
Like, so you move like one of those inflatable...
Spastic on beat, I think was the...
Spastic on beat?
Yes. Yeah,
that
like,
sounds
on
awesome.
On beat, spastic dancing. And I'm like, I will take it. I'm going to be on the beat. So that's...
Do you have any favorite songs mm-hmm. from that time? Do you remember, or did you not know them? You just moved to them.
You know what? That was what made the DJs so good was that they mixed it up a lot. It was a lot of contemporary, and then there would be, like, they would put a beat over Smells Like Teen Spirit.
Or
they would throw in, like, it was, you know, and there would be, you know, it would be, like, Lauryn Hill, and then, like, the latest, you know, whatever was new. Mm-hmm. I have a really hard time, and I said this to you over the email, too.
Yeah.
Like, I have a hard time when people try to ask me what I listen to, because I have these flashbacks from high school where some guy would be like, well, what do you listen to? And I have to, you know, admit that I lock myself in my bedroom and listen to the Ani DeFranco catalog. And my dad's, like, Sgt. Pepper's album. And, like, that's it. Mm-hmm. And, like, I grew up, like, my parents were children of the 60s.
Yeah.
We had a lot of Joan Baez and Bob Dylan in the house.
Yeah.
We had a massive record collection, so I was kind of like... And my dad actually has an amazing record collection.
Yeah.
It's, he's got all the... And it's, like, sort of the upsides of hoarding. because, like, he's got his stuff from his mother. Like, he's got Bessie Smith on 78.
Oh, my
like,
God.
All these, like, amazing...
So you grew up with all of that.
The
thing is I find for myself, mm-hmm. If I'm locking myself in my room to listen mm-hmm. to something, it'll be stuff that I can sing along to. And more often than not, it's like emotive, right? Mm-hmm. But not in that say anything kind of emotive. It's going to be maybe Liz Phair from the 90s or something. Mm-hmm. Or it's going to be Joni Mitchell. Or mm-hmm. it's going to be Throwing Muses or something, you know, whatever. But mostly it's my 90s girl rock that I get all like, that's sing along really loud to. Or maybe like Concrete Blonde, if you know.
Oh yeah,
because her voice is amazing.
Oh my God!
Right.
That was what we in my house. We went through a Joey period recently, where it's like, wake up in the morning, Alexa, play Joey.
And when you said I scared you, well, I guess
about dancing. You already saying, you were saying it was like dance hall and reggaeton. So I think it's interesting that you liked, it sounds like in the hip hop, it sounds like you like kind of the more tropical almost sounding stuff.
Tropical.
Yeah, kind of islandy sort of, in a way.
Yeah. Fitting the tropical summer continues.
Yes.
I do like that. Well, it's just so easy to like, you know, it's
to
just
move
so
to
easy
it.
To move to. Mm-hmm. And that was always, you know, I felt less self-conscious trying to do that. And then also, I will say that any night that I'm behind the bar after 10 p.m. the Tribe Called Quest radio station goes on, and I'm just like, we're just listening to old school hip hop right now,
like old school 90s stuff.
Yeah, like 90s hip hop, because that is all I want to, it's all I want to close the bar to. And then, but actually, you know what, my like playlist glory day I think was in the late 2000s in Williamsburg, Brooklyn. I worked in an amazing little neighborhood bar called Nita Nita, RIP. And that was actually, the woman who owned Nita Nita was like the mom. She was like the you know, den mother for everyone who worked there.
Yeah.
And I like to tell people this bar was like the island of misfit toys. And you had complete autonomy over, you know, you had complete autonomy over the music, well, whoever was behind the bar. You know,
oh, wow.
Complete autonomy. And so.
That's great, because there's a great sense of identity of who you're working with
right.
that day, or if you're coming to the bar, who's there. And
exactly.
You know.
People will be like, come on, Pat tonight.
That's even
Pat
more.
Has the best,
totally,
you know,
even more neighborhood vibe.
And yeah. there were a ton of musicians that worked there, and so they would bring some really cool stuff. And but mine was just like getting a massive internet radio station with the most random, it was like this like, you know, very early like Spotify knockoff program
yeah.
that we had installed. And I would just be like, all right, we're going to listen to Replacements and Not a Surf and Alanis Morissette, you know, or, and then, you know, who else, and like Katy Perry.
Yeah.
I was just like, I heard this song today and I liked it. It's going in the list. Like, which sounds really disjointed, yeah. but it actually just works.
It's not. Because at the end of the day, it's still put together by you.
Yes.
So there is still that thread, as thin as it may sound sometimes. There tends to be a connectivity you can't help.
Yeah.
You know?
No, that's true. Mm-hmm. It's like how we like to think, we're unpredictable. But
yeah,
not.
But we're totally not. We're totally not.
Oh, and my best like girl music story. I actually thought about this today, and I thought of you, and I was like, I have to tell this story. So when I was in college, this was actually my first time I worked at a bar. I was pouring, and it was like a one-off gig at this place that I used to hang out at. So
they
I wasn't
let
working.
You work one day.
Well, it was like the university bar crawl because it was college town, Binghamton, New York.
Oh. Do you go to SUNY Binghamton?
Yeah, oh, yeah.
We'll talk more later. I know a lot of people from Binghamton.
Yeah.
I dated a guy that went to SUNY who was from Binghamton.
So everyone he knew went to Binghamton because
yeah.
it's that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was an anomaly in that because I'm not from Long Island and or Westchester.
These people were from Binghamton.
Oh, really?
Or, yeah, a lot of them were from around there. Twilight Zone land, you know. Yeah.
Yes, literally.
Literally,
we're Rob Twilight Sterling Zone. High School. Mm-hmm. But anyway, so I was at Fitzy's Irish Pub in Binghamton, New York.
I've totally heard of that place.
Oh, my God. And it was, you know, a very classic dive,
yeah.
all dives. And, you know, and I was hanging out with some people who were working with, I was working with at a local restaurant. And they were kind of locals. They were a little rough around the edges. They were, like, more, I was the college girl. I was like, oh,
yeah.
they're so much cooler than me.
Yeah.
They're more worldly than me. And so it was, like, after, like, three or four, you know, loggers. I go over to the jukebox and I put on a bunch of things, including Least Complicated by the Indigo Girls, which was just like, I was like, oh, I really want to hear this right now. Maybe no one will know it's me. And then, like, it gets closer and closer to coming up, and I'm standing around this bar with all these sort of like roughneck style people, and the song comes on, and I'm like, oh, you guys, I'm really embarrassed right now. I just put something on. Like, I don't know. Maybe it was a mistake. I don't know. And all of a sudden, like, these, like, cool, like, biker chicks and their boyfriends were just, like, singing along.
Jamming. They knew it already.
They were jamming out to, like, the Indigo Girls. And I was just like, okay, I was wrong. Then I'm like, oh, no, it's a country song. Like,
when you did that one day at that bar, what were you doing there? Were you just serving, slinging beers to everybody?
I was pouring beers to mobs of college students. It was
yeah.
one of these things. It was like the university pub crawl. So
yeah.
everybody got a plastic cup,
and you fill it for
$2. And I didn't know how to pour a beer. It was mostly foam for everyone, but I was just like, it's $2.
They probably didn't want it. Well, $2, it's
yeah.
fine. They get whatever they got.
Or it was $2 beers or a shot of Rumplemans.
So, of what?
Rumplemints.
Oh my God. That's so college.
Yes.
So college.
So much you have to get.
And did somehow this inspire you to continue being a bartender? or it was just kind of like.
It definitely inspired me to continue hanging out in bars. Well, and fun fact, it actually let me put, when I moved to New York City a couple years later, on my resume that I had bar experience.
Oh, nice.
So I was just like, I worked at Fitzy's for one day. I had bar experience.
Yeah, but that was a hell of a day. So yes. It might have counted for a lot more than one day.
Yeah, it was like maybe two Fridays.
We'll lock it up to that. Yeah. So now here at
Rappahannock.
Mm-hmm. She sees me looking up. Rappahannock. What is the music program here? Do you get to have any say in that? Mm-hmm. Or is that more,
really? It is. Well, now that I'm supervising, doing a little front of house, supervising. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's pretty relaxed. Actually, Anthony, the GM, mm-hmm. is an amazing builder of playlists. So I usually just fall back on his, I'll look at the system and be like, this is so good. I'll just play this. And it's a mixture. They do a lot of indie poppy stuff. But then, he'll mix it up with some R&B and some different stuff. Yeah. There was, a few years ago when we were working together at a different restaurant, there was the weekend phase where we were just listening to a lot of The Weeknd. And that was okay.
And you're kind of okay with that being over now?
Yeah. I'm like, it was really fun at the time.
Do you have any other drinks that have been inadvertently named after musicians
see.
Or songs or anything? In your past, you had to have come up with one or two.
Yes.
But this is like the quiz show question where I put you on the spot, so you're going to go blank.
So I'm just trying to think of what did I make?
I know I have.
I'm like, prior cocktail menus, there was some that were all movie themed or mm-hmm. TV themed. So that was...
That's a lot of fun too, actually.
Yeah, so that was...
And
that
we different. Are we live in a Hollywood town, so that does come up.
We were definitely playing to the crowd there.
Yeah.
We go work in a bar in Nashville, and I'm sure it'll be much
all
different.
Country songs or something like that.
Then I'd be like, each of these songs is named after a Gillian Welch song, or each of these something. Drinks is named after a Gillian Welch
right?
song, and they're all super bitter
yeah.
and depressing and sad, and you'll love it, because I love it. Pretty much the theme.
Oh my God, I love that. I would like to see that menu. Actually, not right now in my life. I'm very happy,
right.
but still, mm-hmm. What's your heart has been broken.
Here's your everything is free. Don't enjoy it.
Because it's not free.
It's not free.
It's
you're
so not free.
$15.
But I think everyone out there in the world would appreciate a heartbreak. That's what you do for Valentine's Day.
Oh my gosh, the heartbreak cocktail menu.
Heartbreak cocktail menu.
I'm doing it.
There we go. Okay, mm-hmm. So let's scroll back to
yes.
any other drink menus.
Let's see.
Any drink music menus. Cocktails you might have had. They're out there. If not, you have ideas there. Brewing.
I do.
No replacements one?
Not yet. I feel like there's got to be something. There's got to be some line from the... You did the best time at your party song. Is that that? No, that's somebody else.
But Replacements.
Replacements is I Can Hardly Wait.
Yeah.
I Can Hardly Wait, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, there's so many. So yeah. many of his songs. But at the same time, since you guys serve beer here, you could do a beer, sort of beer cocktail.
Mm-hmm.
And that could be the Replacements one.
Because
they were notorious for Mm-hmm. The Guided by Voices too. That's another band notorious for the beer on stage and everything.
Oh, that's true. You know what? I should just investigate that. I mean,
and
I think
with the beer a little bit.
You know what? I think
does beer and soju go together? I don't know. I've never.
I mean, I'm sure. I'm sure it can. I'm sure it has. I mean, it has in my belly a lot. Led to probably.
Well, then how about?
Oh, you know what? There should be. You know what? No, this should. I'm gonna do a beer and soju cocktail with height and soju, and I'm gonna call it Common People, because that is always the end of that combination. Is that I'm in front of a room of semi strangers singing Common People very badly.
And everybody likes a
like
good
you,
beer.
Like you, especially you.
Yeah. We do love that song. Oh, it's so good. It's so good. Perfect.
Mm-hmm.
It's so perfect. So, then we'll switch over to the. You've heard some of the podcasts, so you already have heard the. What are your pairings? like what song with what drink kind of thing.
Okay.
You know? And that could be one you've created or not. Just, you know, you just like a Manhattan with a Frank Sinatra, you know, whatever.
Ooh,
maybe.
Okay. I should have thought of this beforehand. I didn't. Well, right now we're listening to some Missy Elliott, which means that Jamie has taken over the playlist, and we're going to get some 90s hip hop in, which I'm excited about.
Excellent.
And
I'm going to my bar after this, and it's Friday, so we're probably going to have the 90s hip hop R&B playlist on, and it's always fun.
Mm-hmm.
It's always the funnest, honestly, and I think even for like 15-year-olds, the 90s R&B and hip hop playlist is still the funnest.
Yeah, which actually... Not so fun sidetrack. That's when I knew I was an old bartender, was when somebody sitting at my bar say, "Oh, I'm so jealous of you. You actually were like, you got to live through the 90s and enjoy it."
I'm like, you're all, thanks. I'll be punching you in the face in a second. So we've got Missy on, and what is your drink with your Missy?
Where's my Missy Elliott drink? Well, she's always, what is she's talking about? I feel like that's got to be, I would drink Missy Elliott with the sidecar.
Ooh.
It's like super classy cognac.
Nice. That's good.
I don't know. Or maybe, yeah.
See, I think of 90s, when I think of 90s R&B, I always think of TLC.
Ooh.
Right?
Yes.
And then I'm like, well, what drink would I have with TLC?
Because
they seem like there's a drink that goes with them. Mm-hmm. I just don't know what it is because I don't have that brain, you know? But there's one.
Yeah. I'm racing right now. I'm trying to think of it for you. I'm just like, what's it?
I don't think it's wine.
No. I'm thinking something like bubbly.
I was thinking bubbly too.
Right.
I'm like, maybe it's a Prosecco something.
Yes. Hmm. Some kind of spritz.
Like a spritz. Okay.
You know what? I would do it with a Chinar spritz.
Ooh.
Because it's sweet and bitter.
Yeah.
It's bittersweet. We're all thinking about the friends that we've lost or the love that's been lost between our friends and bandmates. And you want something bittersweet but still effervescent. And
nice.
I don't know about you, but Chinar always like makes me
Chinar.
Crazy.
Doesn't make me crazy, but I love Chinar. And the regular Chinar or that Chinar 75 or whatever that
is. I can't deal with the overproof. I just like the regular.
Just the regular.
Yeah. I mean, I like the overproof because it's fun to play with, but I kind of just like, you just kind of sip on your artichokes a little bit.
Yeah. Those are great. Mm-hmm. I love it. So we could probably wrap with that.
Okay.
We just tell people again, like, where they can find you, and they can find you all over the place for the next couple of months.
Yes. So, I mean, Movers and Shakers.
You must have a website. I know you have a blog, because I remember I would read your writing up on the blog before all of this.
Really?
Yes,
I really
totally.
Look at that.
Well, you would post. I remember you would post sometimes, hey, I wrote a thing. And then I'd read the thing, and I'm like, gosh, she's really good. She's so clever with the writing. So,
see, that's interesting, because I don't know if it's similar with the podcast or the radio show. But
you can't really tell.
When I... put things up on my personal blog, I'm just like, oh, no one's gonna read this.
It's out there in the void.
I'm just like, maybe my best friends will look at it and they'll say, ha ha ha.
I am surprised when people are like, oh yeah, I totally listened. I'm like, really? Oh, that's so nice of you.
I know. Gosh. Well, thank you. I should really make sure that I did a good job. So my website is my name, basically. It's hopeewing.com. Mm-hmm. Ewing like JR, like Patrick, Ewing. which are also references that are getting kind of dated now, but I'm like, there's gotta be a new...
But I know them as well. I remember the summer of who shot JR.
Oh my gosh, I remember that too. People ask me that all the time.
Yeah. So is your book info on that same website?
Book info is on the website. Okay. Also, we're available for pre-order, Amazon, IndieBound. Look it up on your, you know, local indie bookstore.
Yeah, and it's Movers and Shakers.
Movers and Shakers.
And this book will be out by the time I air this.
Okay.
It comes out, I believe, is it
October
9th? October 9th. It comes out. Okay.
Mm-hmm. And I'll be in New York the day after Halloween at Word Bookstore with Natalka Burian, who's also putting out a book called A Woman's Drink. And she's amazing. She owns Elsa and Ramona.
Oh, wow.
The cocktail bars in Brooklyn. Mm-hmm. And we'll be doing that event together. And then actually in the Bay Area... on the 16th in Oakland and the 17th in Napa, we're going to be doing events. The Napa event is going to be at St. Clair Brown Winery, which is going to be super fun. And then the Oakland event on the 16th is I'm going to have like... I'm doing them all as panels because I kind of think readings are really boring. So I'm just
more people there.
Inviting women who work in the industry to come sit with me, and I'm going to ask them questions.
So great.
And I'm hoping it's just going to be an extension of the book.
Oh, that's awesome.
So... just being like, how'd you get your cool job? What was your first job? What do you like to drink?
I will send my people to you in Oakland. Absolutely. for sure, because I know so many that would just love that. And New York, too. So people go to your website, Movers and Shakers. Yep. You can buy it on Amazon and the other places out there.
Yep, Barnes & Noble, the whole tour. Meal.
And then if they want to encounter your beverages and see you in person, then it's here
at the Rappahannock Oyster Bar.
Oyster Bar in the Row in downtown L.A.
Yes, and get some oysters because they are amazing.
Oh, yeah, totally. Really, I mean, I'm guessing there are things other than oysters, but I saw all the oysters, and that's all I want.
Oh, yeah, and I mean, we have a really excellent, chef here, L.A. chef. Nick Urban is of Urban and St. Martha before that, and he's you know, amazing.
Yeah.
His food's, I'm just trying to pair as well as possible.
I'm sure it's wonderful. Mm-hmm. I love what's here in front of us, so we're doing great. Okay.
You know what? I thought of a pairing.
Yes!
Ani DeFranco, dog coffee with this thing that I made. And you know what? You know what? This is going to be a drink. It's going to be called dog coffee because it's shot.
I was going to say, is that a drink?
The shot of espresso and a shot of Angostura, Amaro Angostura.
Oh, wow.
And just like a dollop, just make it into a little cortado.
It's all right. Say, keep talking.
Okay. Okay. I'm just, again, make a little cortado with just a little bit of dark chocolate in it.
You can do that here.
Yeah.
You can do that in the wintertime.
I can do that in the wintertime.
In LA winter, for as cold as it
gets. It's
going to
be 60 degrees. We're all going to be bundled up with the heat lamps on.
It's true.
We're going to be drinking little dog
We're going to have a little dog coffee. Perfect. Mm-hmm. Well, thank you on that note. Thanks so much, Hope. I really appreciate it. Good luck with the book. I can't wait to read it. Quiet, hush your mouth, silence when I spit it out, in your face, open your mouth, give you a taste, holla, ain't no stopping me, copywritten so don't copy me, y'all do it sloppily, and y'all can't come close to me. Thanks so much to Hope for sitting down with us today. It was a lovely chat, and remember, you want to go to the Facebook page for this podcast, which is Mo Herms over on Facebook, because I have a lot more info there. I will have links to her book. You want to go to her website, which is Hope Ewing, EWING.com, and you can get event information if you want to see if she's coming to your town to speak about this wonderful book that she's got out, again called Movers and Shakers, Women Making Waves in Spirits, Beer, and Wine. You can check her out when she's back in town at the Rappahannock Oyster Company. Did I get that right? Oyster House. And all that info. Plus, of course, the Spotify playlist that Hope came up with for you to listen to. So go to the Facebook page, Mo Herms, check all that stuff out, and buy the book, support local artists. Well, support underground indie artists. And it's a really wonderful educational look at so many different kinds of spirits and everything. So thanks, Hope. And let's listen to some more music for a sec anyway. Music and Booze with Mo is brought to you by Barkeeper, a head shop for cocktail lovers, located at 614 North Hoover Street in Silver Lake, Los Angeles. Stop by for barware, vintage glassware, a carefully curated collection of spirits, and one of the most impressive selections of bitters anywhere. Follow them on Instagram and Facebook for information regarding spirits tastings. That's barkeepersilverlake.com. And also in the Virgil Village neighborhood of Silver Lake, Los Angeles. Thanks for tuning in to our barroom chats on Music and Booze with Mo. For more info about today's guests and our Spotify playlist, check out my Facebook page, Mo Herms. Please subscribe to the podcast and feel free to tell all your friends about it. Lower your expectations and join us at the bar. Till next time, cheers.